Archiving started.
Okay, have everybody's attention. I'd like to introduce our speaker today. This is Christopher Johns-Krull from he's an associate professor in physics at Rice University. And we met last semester. I was at Rice giving a talk to the astrophysics group and just had an interesting conversation. And I thought, he'd be a good speaker to have here for you guys. So since the focus of this talk is on physics and space science, then it's a great candidate. So I'd like to turn it over to Dr. Krull.
Hey, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. So I'm going to talk about the origin of the brown dwarf desert, and I'll define those terms. So I should say up front, I'm in the physics and astronomy department. I'm an astronomer. So the space physics that we're talking about is going to be quite outside our solar system, but it's related to our solar system. And that's one of the things that I think is so exciting about this area of research and something that people are generally very interested in. Before I get started, though, I should recognize collaborators and funding agencies. And you'll see all of my slides have both the Rice symbol, but also the symbol of Lowell Observatory. Because my primary collaborator in the work I'm going to be describing to you is Lisa Plato, an astronomer at Lowell Observatory. And then there are a number of other faculty at different places, Pat Hardig and Dan Jaffe, Chaz Weitman, but also a number of graduate students that have taken part in this work as well. Naved, Chris Crockett, Wilson, and Way, and Marcos are all graduate students. And the work has been funded primarily through either NASA or the National Science Foundation, and NASA has provided funding through a few different avenues, including money that came from the SIM satellite, which is no longer going to be built, but it was, we got the money to do some precursor observations, and also through the Keck Observatory. NASA provides time on the Keck Observatory, and they also provide some funding to go along with that. So, in general, we live in very exciting times in the area of extrasolar planet research. And this origin of the brown dwarf desert that I'm going to talk about is related to the whole process of planet formation. And as I was putting the final touches on this talk yesterday, I looked up on some of the one of the main sites that tracks these things, and there are about 4,200 known extrasolar planets, the planets outside of our solar system right now. I put known in quotation marks here because most of these planets or planet candidates have been discovered by the Kepler space mission, which is staring at a region of the sky, and it's looking to see if there's a planet that happens to go in front of its star. That makes the star get a little bit dimmer, and so you can see that there's something there. But in many cases, those planets haven't been confirmed by any other type of observation, primarily because the stars are very faint. The whole field of extrasolar planets really got started in 1995 with this discovery of an object called 51 Pegasi b, and that was discovered by looking at the star itself and watching the star appear to move. And we'll go over this in more detail, but this is the radial velocity signature of the star, seeing it going both to positive and negative velocities of a few meters per second. And it was that told us that there was a planet there. But now we've also been able to start to directly image some planets around other stars as well. This is the star HR 8799. This is actually just the residuals of the star. They put an occulting device in front of the telescope that tries to blot out the star light so that you don't get a lot of scattered light from the very bright star. And when you do that, you can see very faintly three faint companions nearby that turn out to be planets on the order of 8 to 10 Jupiter masses. And so, taken all together, there's a little over 4,000 planets known outside of our solar system. And one of the questions that we naturally want to ask is, well, how did they get there? We're interested in also how did the planets of our solar system get there? Ultimately, we're exploring the question of our own origins, and in fact, it's the NASA Origins of Solar System Funding Agency that has funded a lot of this. So origins is a word we like to kick around a lot in the field. So we're going to talk about stars, planets, and brown dwarfs. So let's define these in case it's not obvious what we mean. A star, the sun is a star, any star that you see out in the night sky, by definition, is fusing hydrogen into helium in its core. That's where it gets its source of energy. Brown dwarfs and planets don't do that. But it turns out that brown dwarfs, at some time in their life, were able to fuse deuterium in their core. It turns out the temperature that you need to fuse deuterium is quite a bit less than the temperature you need to fuse hydrogen. And so brown dwarfs were able to do that. And then planets, by definition, these definitions are handed down from the International Astronomical Union, planets are so low in mass that they never could fuse deuterium or hydrogen. And the key there is mass. The temperature at the center of the sun is primarily determined by mass. The temperature at the center of all stars is determined by their mass. And so brown dwarfs are less than about 80 times the mass of Jupiter, which is 0.08 times the mass of the sun. And brown dwarfs were hot enough in their centers to fuse deuterium, but not hot enough to fuse hydrogen. And then the planets were never hot enough to fuse anything. Some people don't like that definition of what makes a planet based purely on mass. Some people would prefer to define a planet as an object that forms in a disk around a star. And that then gets into our whole picture of how we think the planets of our solar system form, which we'll come to in a moment. So now let's define the brown dwarf desert. And so brown dwarfs are these objects that are a little bit less massive than stars, a little bit more massive than planets. And because they're relatively low in mass, they're kind of hard to find. But the techniques that people use to find planets around other stars would be very, very good at finding brown dwarfs around other stars because the brown dwarfs are bigger and easier to see. And so if you make a plot of the mass of something around a star, and so this dotted line is at 13 Jupiter masses, which defines a planet. So anything down here is a planet because it's 13 Jupiter masses or less. Anything up here is a star because it's 80 Jupiter masses or more. And this is just what are the companions to stars that we see nearby? And we see a fair number of planets. We see a fair number of stars as companions, so these would be two stars orbiting each other. This would be a planet orbiting a star. We see almost none of these brown dwarfs. And so that lack of brown dwarfs is what is referred to as the brown dwarf desert. And the question then is, well, why should there be a lack of these brown dwarf objects when we have plenty of things more massive and plenty of things less massive? Why are we ruling out this mass in between? That's what we're hoping to understand. So then that goes into the question of how do we think we form planets and brown dwarfs and so forth. And that kind of gets us to the general picture of star formation. So not drawn to scale, but a star in our galaxy, in any galaxy, forms when some piece of the galaxy that is composed of gas and dust becomes so dense and so cold that its own gravity takes over and it begins to collapse in on itself. It undergoes what we refer to as a gravitational collapse. So you're supposed to assume that this is some big gas cloud that has started to fall in on itself under the influence of its own gravity. But because it's in a galaxy that's spinning, everything pretty much in the universe is spinning a little bit, that gas cloud is spinning. And so you have to conserve angular momentum. And so just like the ice skater, when they pull in their arms, as they start to spin faster. As the cloud gets smaller and smaller when it's collapsing, it starts to spin faster. And that makes it hard for it to continue to collapse in the direction that is perpendicular to its rotation axis. It doesn't want to collapse in this way if it's rotating around.
but there's nothing preventing it from collapsing down. And so it naturally forms a very flattened structure. And at the center of that flattened structure is where the young star forms. The stuff that's in the middle of the cloud can collapse all the way down and form the star. But there's a bunch of stuff that's in the outer parts of the cloud that can't make it all the way in, and it forms this flattened disc-like structure. And we think in that disc, then, is where the planets form. And that general picture very naturally explains many of the things we observe about our solar system.
If you look at the planets in our solar system,
again, this is not drawn to scale, but one thing that is very accurate about it is all the planets in our solar system are basically in the same orbital plane. They all share the same orbital plane, and that plane is pretty much lined up with the equatorial axis of the equator of the sun. And that is what you would expect if everything formed in a flattened disk around the star. And all the planets are orbiting the sun in the same direction, and that's what you would expect if all the planets formed in a disk.
And so this is a general picture that explains a lot of the things we see in our solar system and has gained a lot of acceptance.
But there's still a question of, okay, even if planets form in their disk, how do they actually go about doing it? And there are sort of two main ideas out there. Now, this disk of material is composed mainly of hydrogen gas, and it's molecular hydrogen gas because it's so cold. Most of the stuff in the universe is hydrogen, so we expect most of that to be hydrogen. But there are trace amounts of all the other things, the carbon, the oxygen, the iron, the magnesium, the silicon, everything that makes all the stuff around us is also in those disks. But the form that it takes is in very small dust grains. And this is a dust grain that was captured from a satellite launch from our solar system. And these dust grains are smaller than a micron, so it's smaller than the dust that's in your rooms and collecting on your shelves. They're very small, but when they're going around in the disk, they can run into each other, they can stick together. And then they can run into a few other dust particles and stick together. And then they can run into a few other dust particles and stick together and slowly build up bigger, more massive things. And if you wait long enough to build up something that's maybe 10 times the mass of the Earth, a rocky thing that's 10 times the mass of the Earth, then the gravity of that object is so large that it can pull in a lot of the gas around it in this disk and make Jupiter. And so our models of how you make Jupiter assume that you get a bunch of this dust sticking together to build up bigger and bigger and bigger things until you get about 10 Earth masses, and then the gas near Jupiter collapses down onto the planet from the gravity of that 10 Earth mass thing, and you build Jupiter, which is about 330 Earth masses, to give you a scale. Well, so this involves a lot of dust particles sticking together over time, and the idea is that takes a while to do, and our best guesses for that is it takes about 10 million years to build up, to build a Jupiter mass object. The competing theory says that actually the disks around these young stars are much more massive than we think they are. And it turns out it's kind of hard to measure the mass of a disk. So there is an uncertainty there. And if the disks are more massive than we think they are, then you have to worry about the gravity of the disk itself before anything collapses down. And you can get instabilities in this disk, and you can directly collapse a piece of the disk to form planets, and perhaps more than one planet, if the disk is massive enough. That's called the gravitational instability model. The nice thing about it is it only takes about 100,000 years to form a Jupiter mass planet with that model, but it does require that the disk be quite massive, and there's controversy over whether disk can actually be that massive.
So that's kind of the setting of our story.
One of the things that we can say is that we observe disks around newly formed stars all the time. So that part of the story seems to be correct. In some fortuitous cases, we can actually take pictures of these disks. So these are all images taken with the Hubble Space Telescope, and they are images of disks around stars where you happen to be in the fortuitous situation that the disk is lined up with our line of sight. And so you don't actually see the star in the middle. The star is blocked by the disk, but the disks are not infinitely thin things. They have some thickness to them. The density gets smaller and smaller as you get up towards the surface of it, and the dust particles in the surface of this can scatter the starlight towards us. And so what you're seeing here is scattered light from the star by the upper and lower layers of the disk. If that disk was oriented face on, the star would be so bright we wouldn't be able to see the disk at all. So these are fortuitous cases where we happen to see the disk lined up just right. But one of the things that disks also do is they're a lot colder than the star. The star is maybe a young star like the sun, would form with a temperature of about 4,000 degrees. But the disk itself is anywhere from about 1,000 to 1,500 degrees near the center. It gets colder as you get further away. But that disk can emit infrared light. And if you were to take a spectrum, a broadband spectrum of a star, where you're measuring either its as a function of wavelength going in this direction or frequency going in this direction. If you had just a star there, you would get something that looks like this. For those of you that are familiar with black body radiation, stars look like black bodies. So if there was just a star, you would see this. But if there's a disk, you would see that black body from the star, but then you would see a lot of extra emission at longer and longer wavelengths. And that emission is coming from the disk. And it's at longer wavelengths because the disk is colder. And so what we can do is we can look in regions where we see forming stars, and we can see a few of these guys, but we can measure to see if there's an infrared excess. And in basically, in very young regions of star formation, almost all of the stars have infrared excesses. So they almost all seem to be formed with disks.
So the disks are quite common.
But we want to probe a little bit more about the star, and in particular, we want to look for evidence of planets or brown dwarfs. And the main way we do that is by taking a spectrum and taking a higher resolution spectrum than what I showed before. So you know, we're basically passing light through some sort of dispersing element like a prism. And in particular, we want to look at the spectral lines. And so this is a spectrum, so the intensity of the light is a function of wavelength showing some gas that just has hydrogen in it. And so you see the primary optical lines of hydrogen. This is the H alpha line, H beta, H gamma, H delta on up the sequence. The spectrum of the sun actually looks like this because it has a lot more than just hydrogen in it. Most of these spectral lines that you see here are from the element iron, but some of them are from oxygen, nitrogen, sodium, and so forth. And the main thing that we're going to be interested in, there's two things that we're interested in. If an object has more of these heavy elements, it has more iron or more carbon or more silicon, it'll have more of these lines and the lines will be stronger, they'll be deeper, they'll get stronger. So you can use a spectral line to learn about what elements are in a star and how much of those elements are in a star. You can also use a spectral line to measure if the star is moving. So, and there you use the Doppler shift. It's just like if you've ever heard an ambulance or a train as it's coming towards you, its siren or its whistle is high pitched, and as it's moving away from you, it goes to a lower pitch. That's because of the Doppler shift of sound. Light does the same thing. If a star happens to be moving towards you, all of these individual spectral lines get shifted to slightly shorter wavelengths. They get blue shifted. And if the star is moving away from you, those lines get shifted to the longer wavelengths. They get red shifted. And so you can tell if a star is moving by looking at the wavelength of its spectral lines and see if they are at a different wavelength than what they should be. So what are some of the observational clues that we can gather for these star formation models? Well, one of the things I mentioned was by measuring these spectral lines, we can tell how much material is in the star. And since we think the stars and the disks all form out of the same thing, we think that by measuring how much material is in a star, that tells us how much of this heavy element stuff is in the disk. And so I said that dust was made of the carbon and the silicate and iron and stuff like that. If you have more carbon and silicate and iron in the cloud that the star formed out of, you would have more of these dust grains, and maybe it's easier to build planets if you're relying on the dust grains sticking together, if that's the model you like. And so what we do is we look at stars that are known to host planets, and we measure, this is a measure of how much iron is in them. The units of this are on a logarithmic scale, but the bottom line is, if you're over on this side of the graph, you've got more iron in the star. If you're on this side of the graph, you've got less iron in the star. And all the stars with known planets are these guys here in blue. All the stars that people look for planets around are these guys in green. And the bottom line is, if you have more iron in your star, you're more likely to have a planet. So that seems to support this idea that you need these dust grains, you need these little seeds that can stick together. So this was taken as strong support for that, what's called a core accretion model, where the dust particles are sticking together. But the knock against the core accretion model is that those disks may not last long enough. These are regions where stars are forming, a bunch of different ones, and this is the frequency of disks as diagnosed by that infrared emission that we talked about a couple of slides ago. And so the very newly formed stars, again, 85% plus or minus, 7.5% of the stars have disks around them, the really young stars, in the really young clusters. But in the older clusters, that disk fraction goes down, and by the time you get out to 10 million years, there's almost no disk. And by the time you get out to 5 million years, well, you're down to 20% or less. And if it takes 10 million years to build a Jupiter, then maybe you just don't have enough time. And so there's a concern that maybe disks just don't last long enough. And so maybe you need another mechanism, like the gravitational instability. Well, then, what do people think maybe is the origin of the brown dwarf desert? And there's two leading hypotheses. One is that there's some feature that we don't really know what, but maybe the disks themselves just aren't massive enough. Because if you're going to build a massive object like a brown dwarf, which again may be 30, 40, 50 times the mass of Jupiter, you need a lot of stuff there in the disk. And if the disk is just not massive enough, then you can't build a brown dwarf. That may be one idea. There's another idea that says actually the brown dwarfs do get formed, but in order to form a brown dwarf, we need a relatively massive disk. And something that we have discovered is that when you have a relatively massive planet, like a Jupiter mass planet or more massive than Jupiter, orbiting a star that has a relatively massive disk, the disk and the planet interact with each other gravitationally such that the planet migrates in, and in some cases may go all the way in and get swallowed by a star. And so the idea would be then, if you have a disk that's so massive that it can form a brown dwarf, that brown dwarf would very quickly migrate in and get eaten by a star. And if what's left over in the disk is massive enough, maybe you form another brown dwarf, and it migrates in and gets eaten by a star, until a disk becomes so low in mass that you can no longer build a brown dwarf. So there's two competing models for this brown dwarf desert. One says it's just always there. It's something about the formation process that maybe we don't quite understand, but it's always there. And the other model says, well, they actually do form at very young ages when you have disks, but they didn't get eaten by their stars. So we would like to be able to explore that possibility. So the best way to determine whether or not there are planets or brown dwarfs around very young stars is to look at very young stars and see if you find planets or brown dwarfs around them. I started out by saying that there's about 4,000 known planets around other stars, but all those stars are middle-aged stars like the Sun. All the studies that people are doing, most of the studies that people are doing to look for planets around other stars are around stars very much like the Sun that are several billion years old. They're not looking at these stars that are only a couple million years old. And I'll explain why. It turns out the young stars are outrageous and very active, and they don't want to be nice and follow the rules. And it turns out it makes it hard to look for the planets and brown dwarfs around them. And I'll explain why that is. So we're going to look for planets around very young stars. And if any of you have ever seen the Great Orion Nebula in the constellation Orion, so it's in the sword of Orion, you can see it up this time of year very nicely. That is a region in our galaxy relatively close by, only about 1,500 light years away, that is forming stars right now. There's about 3,000 or so very young stars only a couple million years old there. And there are other regions as well. So people have looked for planets around some relatively young stars that are only 600 million years old, and again, our sun is about 4.5 billion years old. So 600 million years is actually young for a star. But people didn't find any planets around them. People have also looked at some other stars that are maybe in the range of 12 to 300 million years old, but again, didn't find any planets there. But these sample sizes were relatively small, and so you do have to worry about the sample size. Now, that's not to say that people haven't thought that they have found any planets. There are a few cases where people think that they have been able to directly take a picture of planet-like objects around very young stars. And here are a few examples. And so here is the star, and here's this faint thing nearby. And if you think it's a planet, you put a little b down there. If you think it's another star, you put a big b down there. But the bright thing is capital A, and then the other thing is b, and if it's a little b, it's a planet. If it's a big b, it's a star. So they think this is a planet because it's got a lowercase b, but it turns out that when you just take a picture of something that's separated from a star, you don't really know its mass. And it turns out in order to estimate its mass, you have to rely on theoretical models of how bright planets should be at different ages, and it turns out those models are just very uncertain. So this is the discovery paper where they estimated that this guy up here was maybe only 1.5 to 2 Jupiter masses, but then people revised their models, they got better observations. Now they think it's maybe 30 or 40 Jupiter masses. The bottom line is it's uncertain. It's uncertain by a high degree. And all these other little companions that people have found around some of these young stars, their masses are also very uncertain.
And so we want a better way to get mass. Well, the way you can do that is by doing this radial velocity technique where you actually look for the spectral lines to get blue shifted and red shifted. And that's because if you have a star and a planet, I always like to, when I give a more popular talk, I said, probably at one point in your life, you were told all the planets in the solar system go around the sun. That's a lie. They don't go around the sun. They go around the center of mass of the solar system. And if you had just one planet and one star, they're both orbiting the center of mass, the balance point between the two things. It just so happens that because the star is so much more massive than the planet, that balance point is really close to the star, but the star is still going around. In the case of our solar system, the center of mass of the solar system is a point that's roughly on the surface of the sun. So the sun is kind of wobbling around that point on its surface. And so if you could just measure the star, take a spectrum of the star, it looks like this. As the planet goes around and the star goes around, you would see these spectral lines move back and forth. And that would tell you that there was something there. And you could infer then the existence of a planet.
But not only can you infer the existence of the planet, by seeing the star come towards you and then away from you and towards you and away from you, how long it takes for this to repeat tells you the period. And so this is 51 peg. The period here was only about 4.5 days. The period tells you how far away the planet and the star are from each other. But the amplitude of this sine wave, how much the star is moving, tells you the mass of the planet. If you have a very low mass planet, it's not going to be able to shake the star around very much because the star is going to be going around a circle that's really, really close to the center of mass. If you have a really massive planet, it's going to be able to shake the star around a lot, and you will see that as a high amplitude sine wave or curve and that will then tell you the mass of the planet. So these radial velocities actually let us measure the mass of the planet, or brown dwarf, or whatever it is, which is an important fact. And here is an example of a planet around another star that we discovered at Rice. And again, this high amplitude curve tells us what the mass is. This also happens to be one of these planets that happens to go in front of its star, so the star gets dimmer when the planet goes in front. Now, you can use that to tell you something about the radius of the planet. But this is just to show you an example that these things work. Well, what about these young stars? Well, there's a couple of things to say about them. They're only a few million years old, but to be totally honest, that's a little uncertain, because what we know about stars like the sun that are calmly fusing hydrogen into helium in their cores, that are what we call on the main sequence, occupy a particular position in what's called an HR diagram, which is just simply a plot of the temperature of the star versus how bright it is, the luminosity, the total amount of light coming out. And stars sit on this main sequence when they're middle-aged stars like the sun, and exactly where they are on this tells you what the mass is. We know how to calibrate that really, really well. But young stars are not fusing hydrogen into helium in the core. In fact, they're shining. The only reason they're shining is because they are actually slowly collapsing. They're slowly getting smaller. And so you're taking gravitational potential energy and you're releasing it because the thing is getting smaller. That goes into heat. It goes into heating up the star and makes it shine. And it actually makes it shine very brightly. So a young star is brighter than it should be, and it's actually a little bit colder than it should be. And so then in order to infer its mass and age, we have to plot it on this HR diagram and then use these theoretical models. This is the path that a half a solar mass star would take. This is the path that a one solar mass star would take, 2, 3, 5, 9, and so forth. And this is, you know, if a star happened to lie right there, we would say, okay, it's half a solar mass and it's a million years old. But those are uncertain. And in some cases, they're uncertain by about a factor of two. So that's something to keep in mind. But the other thing about these young stars is they have huge star spots on them. This is the sun with some sunspots. And some of you may be aware that the sun goes through a magnetic activity cycle. Sometimes it's very active, it produces lots of solar flares, coronal mass ejections, and stuff like that. Sometimes it's very quiescent, takes about 11 years to go from one peak to the next. And this is the sun when it's at its most active, and these are the biggest sunspots. And sunspots are just regions of a very intense magnetic field that cause the surface of the sun to cool down a little bit. You can actually infer what the spots on other stars look like by watching them as they rotate, and you take spectra and you look at these individual spectral lines. This is the same star observed at two different times, and you can see the spectral lines have changed shape. Down here they're kind of pointy, up here they're more flat bottomed, and that's caused by the fact that these spots are basically not emitting light. You're just getting light from the light parts of the star, and you can use tomographic imaging techniques, like what they use for a seismograph to figure out the internal structure of the Earth, or in a ultrasound to get a picture of a baby in the mother's womb. You use basically the same general techniques, the same mathematics, and you can reconstruct what the surface of a star looks like, and we see enormous spots on the surface of these very young stars.
And those enormous spots cause lots of problems. And this is an example of what they do.
So, you know, in order to measure a planet or a brown dwarf, we want to look at those spectral lines and we want to see them go back and forth. Now, when I've been talking about that, I've been kind of exaggerating because I made it look like they go back and forth by a lot. Turns out they go back and forth by a very, very tiny amount. And if this is the width of a spectral line, those planets that I showed you before, 51 Peg and so forth, the spectral line moves back and forth by only about a couple of thousandths of the width of the speckle line. So it's a very, very small amount. And what the spot does is when the spot is on the side of the star that's rotating towards you, you see a little deformation occur in the line, and it propagates through the line as the spot goes around on the surface. And that means what you think is a nice, simple speckle line that you're trying to measure going back and forth is actually a wobbly-looking thing, and it's hard to determine, it's hard to decide what is the exact center of that line. And in order to measure the velocity, you need to know the exact center of that line. And so if you didn't know that there was a spot on there, you might accidentally think that there was something in orbit around it, because it turns out the signature of a spot going around
on a star can look exactly the same as a planet going around the star. And that's why the people who have been looking for extrasolar planets don't look at these young stars, because they're complicated.
Well, is there a way to diagnose the presence of that spot? There's a couple of ways to do it. This is, again, that same spectral line with the deformation in there. This is, you can imagine the spectral line turned upside down. We turn it upside down for the computer calculation just because it's easier to deal with. And we measure what's called the bisector, and that's basically just what is the halfway point between two levels in the spectral line. And if you have something that's very symmetric, you get a bisector that's pretty straight. But if you have something that has this little dent in it, the bisector will have an extra little curvature to it. And what we then actually do is measure the position of this bisector at a point near the center of the line, near the bottom of the line, a point near the top, and we compare that. And what you can find in some cases is that bisector difference that I just talked about is correlated with what you would measure as the velocity of a star. And so if you happen to see a star where you're measuring the velocity, and this is the velocity measurement of a star, it had a nice variation. It looked like maybe there was a planet around there, about 5 Jupiter masses. But we then measured that bisector span and saw that it's correlated with the radial velocity, and that's the telltale signature that this is actually a spot going around on the star and not a planet. So that's one way
you can test to see if something's going on. Okay, so those are the, one other thing.
So we mentioned we want to get the mass. Mass is kind of most important. There was a group that in 2008 claimed to have found a planet around a 10 million year old star. And here are its radial velocities going up and down, up and down. And here are the bisectors. And they said, okay, there's no correlation between the bisector and the radial velocity. And so this has got to be a planet. And it turns out that because you happen to be looking almost straight down on the disk, the velocity that you record here would tell you that this planet was 10 Jupiter masses, around a 10 million year old star. So for a while, this was taken as the youngest planet ever discovered. And we'll come back to it.
So what have we been doing? We've been looking for planets and brown dwarfs around very young stars,
primarily doing that at McDonald Observatory, using three of the different telescopes there, the 2.7-meter telescope, 2.1-meter telescope, and this little 0.8-meter telescope. We take spectra with these two telescopes to try and measure the radial velocity. We actually just measure how bright the star is here, because if it has a spot on it, the brightness should change as well, so that gives us some other information. And we've also been using some other telescopes out at in Arizona at Kitt Peak
National Observatory. And so what we do is we use like the McDonald 2.7-meter telescope, and here is a spectrum of a star like the sun, and each one of these dark areas is a spectral line. And so we're just looking to see if those spectral lines are going back and forth. We're using the same radial velocity technique. And this is just to show you kind of what our velocity precision is.
These are stars that are all known to not have any companions around them. And we get measurements that go up and down, and they scatter by a level of about 120 meters per second. But as I will show you, that's plenty good enough precision to find massive planets, and it's excellent precision to find brown dwarfs,
which is one of the main things we're after. And so this shows you that. So this plot,
the known extrasolar planets that have mass measurements, and this is plotted in Jupiter masses, versus their orbital period in days, so 300 days out here, 355 days would be 1 year for the Earth's orbit. And, you know, there are many planets that are known to be one Jupiter mass, 10 Jupiter masses, and these lines show you where the velocity precision would be. So at 100 meters per second, we should technically be able to find all these guys up here. And brown dwarfs should be way up here. So our velocity precision is down here. It should be really easy for us to find brown dwarfs.
And so if they're there at these very young ages, we should be able to see them. And we've been surveying about 140 stars in the Taurus star forming region. And so, as I showed you before, this is that same star I showed you before. We clearly see some spotted stars.
We see stars that have a radial velocity variation, but their bisectors correlate with that radial velocity, and it's clearly a spotted star, nothing with a companion around it.
And since I mentioned it would be easy to see the brown dwarfs in the first 70 stars that we have now completely surveyed, we haven't seen anything that would have a velocity variation up there that would indicate a brown dwarf. So we're not finding any brown dwarfs at all. And if this brown dwarf, this is to show you the lack of brown dwarfs, if that brown dwarf desert wasn't there from the very beginning, if you were able to form these brown dwarfs but they got eaten, at a rate that you can estimate, we probably should have found two or three brown dwarfs already. So we think that the brown dwarf desert is caused by something about the star formation, planet formation process itself, that idea that you form them and they get eaten, you form them and they get eaten, that's probably not the correct answer. But then the question is, can we find the smaller things? Can we find the planets? And we've had some interesting things happen.
So here's one example of a young star called B and Tau. And here are our radial velocity measurements. And they're kind of noisy. They scatter. But again, these things should have spots on them. They should have big spots on them. So they should have a lot of scatter due to the spots, in addition to maybe any companions there. And here is our bisector variation as a function of radial velocity. And while there's kind of this zone of avoidance down here, there's not a clear correlation like we saw in those couple of examples I showed you before.
So we were really excited about this one. We thought it might be a planet. If you worked things out, it would correspond to a planet of about 6 Jupiter masses.
Here's another star that had a very clear radial velocity signal with a period of only 1.6 days.
This would also be perhaps a more massive companion, maybe, you know, around 14, 15 Jupiter masses, so just barely into that brown dwarf regime. But since extrasolar planets are so popular in astronomy these days, and if you were to claim that you had found these stars only about 2 million years old, so if we were to claim that we had found the youngest planet around any known star, there would be a lot of people who try to prove this wrong. So before we ran off to publish it, we decided we needed to do some additional checks just to make sure we weren't being fooled by something. And we know that there are these spots. That's the thing that worries us the most. And so what else can you do to deal with spots? Well, the reason these spots, even though we've drawn them as black, they're not really black. They are emitting some light because they are at some temperature. It's just that the temperature is less than the rest of the star, and so they don't emit as much light, and they kind of appear black.
And so if you assume that the star is at a temperature of about 4,300 degrees Kelvin, and the spot is about 3,000 degrees Kelvin, both of those things are emitting basically like black bodies. The star spectrum would look like this as a function of wavelength going from the optical out into the infrared. The spot spectrum would look like this. And in the optical, there's a big contrast. The flux ratio in the optical, what we call the V-band, is a factor of 24, meaning that the star is 24 times brighter than the spot at that point. But if you go out into the infrared, the flux ratio in what's called the H-band, which is about 1.5 microns, is only a factor of 3. And if you go out to like 2.3 microns out of what we call the K-band, the flux ratio is only about a factor of 2 or so, a little bit less than that. And so that means the spot makes a smaller and smaller effect as you go to longer and longer wavelengths.
And so we wanted to exploit that. And we weren't the first people who have done that. Actually, people studying isolated brown dwarfs thought that they had found a brown dwarf that had a planet going around it.
And they measured these radial velocities in the optical, getting these solid circles here, and they had this fit to it, and they said, okay, there's a planet going around a brown dwarf. Well, they said, okay, let's go out here in the infrared and repeat the experiment, and that was these open circles here, which show no variation at all, and they said, okay, there's not a planet around this brown dwarf. There's actually clouds on the surface of this brown dwarf, but it's a way to make sure you don't get fooled by something that's not a planet.
So we do basically the same thing. We do our observing for our infrared data at the infrared telescope facility, which is in Hawaii. It's on the island of Mauna Kea, on the big island of Hawaii, on the mountain of Mauna Kea. And it has a spectrograph shown here and hanging off the back of the telescope that we have used to follow up all of our interesting candidates. And what we do when we do that is we actually observe the stellar spectrum shown here in this red thing here. And that spectrum of the star consists of, that we observe, consists of the spectrum from the star itself, which has a lot of spectral lines. In this case, it would be molecule carbon monoxide. And that starlight passes through the Earth's atmosphere, and there's some methane in the Earth's atmosphere, and it gets absorbed. And the next thing that we see then is both the stellar spectrum and the Earth's atmospheric spectrum. And that kind of looks like it might be a problem having the Earth's atmosphere in the way, but it turns out it's a really good thing because these spectral lines from the atmosphere give us a wavelength reference point. And then all we have to do is look at the stellar spectrum and see do those stellar spectral lines move back and forth relative to the lines that are from the Earth's atmosphere. And that lets us get a good measure of the radial velocity. And here is a proof of concept observation that we made. This is a known star that has a known extrasolar planet around it. The observations that discovered it are shown here in these red circles, and they're very high precision observations. That's why there are actually error bars there. You just can't see them because they're so small. And our observations are here in the green squares with our error bars, and it follows the curve like it should with a pretty good velocity precision. If you look at the
velocity precision we're getting in the infrared, it's about 60 meters per second. And again, we're looking for signals that are more on the order of a kilometer per second, so that's very good. And here's another proof of concept. Here's one of those stars that we know has a spot on it because its bisector correlates with its radial velocity, just like we saw before. The optical radial velocities go up and down, but the infrared radial velocities here in the black stay very much constant. So we see this lowering of the amplitude in the infrared just like we expected we would on a spotted star.
So then we looked at our stars that we thought we saw some variation in the optical. This is the one I showed you before. Its infrared radial velocities were very flat. Here's another one that comes down like this. Its infrared velocities are very flat. Even though the bisectors don't correlate,
the infrared velocities don't match up with the optical ones, and that tells us it can't be a planet.
It has to be something else, and we think it's probably a spot. Here's another example of a spotted star. Again, just to demonstrate that the optical velocity shown in blue have a bigger amplitude than the infrared velocity shown in red. So that's a nice thing, and it lets us do a couple of other things. Before we get to that, though, I want to come back to this planet. Remember, I told you, if you say you can claim the planet around the youngest star, people will work very hard to prove you wrong. And so this group in 2008 claimed this planet around TW Ahia, and a group within the year went and looked at the same star in the infrared and found, so these are their infrared observations shown here. This is what they should have seen according to the optical observations, and they didn't see that. And so they published that the people who discovered the planet were wrong. All they discovered was a spot on a star. So you want to be very careful before you make a claim, because somebody will try and prove you wrong. Well, our search goes on. We continue to look for companions around these young stars. We have another very interesting candidate, which I show here. So here are our radial velocities in the optical going up and down. And here's our bisector variations, and they not much of a correlation. So we went and looked in the infrared, and we saw variations in the infrared shown here with a period of about 11 days. Now this is what the optical variations look like on that 11-day period. What I showed you before that looks so nice, this is actually phased up with a 6-day period. So the optical observations seem to indicate there's a 6-day period there. The infrared observations don't really phase up very well with that. They do a better job at 11 days. So how can you explain that? Well, remember, the stars that we've looked at that are clearly spotted, the optical observations have an amplitude that are anywhere from a factor of 2 to 4 times bigger than our infrared amplitude. And these optical observations, this is on the same scale, their variations are at most a factor of 1.2, 1.3 larger. So, but if you had a planet, as shown in this fit here, we know the star is still spinning, we know there's probably a spot on the star, that would add noise to our measurements. It may be that the optical measurements just have so much noise added to them that we can't really see it in the optical, that we can only see it in the infrared because the spot doesn't make such a big impact in the infrared. And again, this is just showing kind of on the same scale. If it has a spot, there should be a big difference between infrared and optical observations, and here, just in amplitude. And here, there's not that big difference in optical and infrared. So we're excited about this one. We have gotten some more infrared data back in early 2013, which again showed some variability on the same period. Unfortunately, our error bars were a little bit larger. So we've been able to go and propose to that NASA infrared telescope facility, and we have 22 nights starting February 1st to follow this up and hopefully nail it down and be able to decide whether this really is a planet. If you believe this type of signature, it works out to be about a 5 or 6 Jupiter mass planet. And we have another target that we're very excited about, showing a pretty large optical variation. And that optical variation is actually larger than what we've seen in our most spotted star. And it turns out that this star is actually spinning not nearly as rapidly as the spotted stars we know about. And in order for a star spot to make a fake radial velocity signal, the star has to be spinning. It has to be spinning relatively rapidly. We know the star is not spinning nearly as rapidly as some of the spotted stars that produce these fake signals. So this is another one, and again, the bisectors don't correlate with the radial velocity. So
over these 22 nights, we're going to be following this diet as well.
So if things go really well, maybe by next semester, I can come back and tell you we've discovered a couple of planets around some very young stars, but I'm not willing to make that claim quite yet.
So I'll just summarize what I've told you. We have an ongoing planet search and brown dwarf search. We haven't found any brown dwarf, so the brown dwarf desert seems to be something that's set from the very beginning of the whole process. We have to watch out for spots, and we have some new candidates that look very promising, but I'm not going to make any bold claims today. Thank you very much.
If there's a way to find out if there's a solid
core
at Jupiter or if there's none,
that
kind of will make one of the
theories? Well, yes, except that Jupiter is so massive that and the pressure is so high in the center that there couldn't be a solid core there at all. In fact, Jupiter is what the center of it is what we call degenerate, meaning that it's held up by degeneracy pressure, which is a product of the Pauli exclusion principle. This means that you can't have two fermions in the same place at the same time. You can't have two electrons in the same place at the same time. That's what holds up Jupiter. So the whole structure of the planet is very, very different than, you know, rocky stuff on Earth. So you couldn't really make that determination.
So going back to the original theory, just thinking that the solid core jump-started it, and from there it's not dissipated.
Well, but you might even expect, I mean, what you're basically asking is there a bunch of rocky, or what was originally rocky material in Jupiter anyway? Well, even if it just gravitationally collapsed from a big section of the disk, there would still be all that rocky material mixed in with the gas, and when it collapsed, the rocky stuff would differentiate and collapse to the center anyway, just like the heavy, you know, the Earth has an iron core because it's differentiated. So you'd still get that differentiation, and that doesn't really tell you exactly how it's formed. Yeah?
As far as the model of supposing that brown dwarfs existed at one point, if there was an indicator that those massive objects being present, could one way to determine or not to determine the presence of would modulations in the accretion flow of the cloud be an indicator of a massive object in the presence?
So, in fact, we do see in young binary stars that the accretion flows are modulated in the case where the orbits of those stars are eccentric. So we don't see it when they're perfectly circular. We see it when they're eccentric. And so if there was a 30 or 40 Jupiter mass brown dwarf on an eccentric orbit near one of these young stars, we would expect there to be modulated accretion, and it would be modulated on the orbital period. So that's one way to verify it. In fact, these stars that we're looking at, because the companions are in the few to tens of Jupiter mass range, we are looking for that modulated signature in the accretion as well. Haven't clearly seen it, but we're looking for it. Let me get this question on the back.
Well, about two-thirds of the way through in the lower left, you had a very detailed spectra at many wavelengths.
Right.
So I come to the conclusion that when the planet goes in front of the sun, as opposed to a huge sunspot, it doesn't change the spectra. It seemed like such a detailed spectra, but it doesn't really change it that you can use that.
So when the planet goes in front of, now, the nice thing about using these radial velocity techniques, and something I kind of glossed over, is if you have a planet going around the star, and going around like this, you see the star moving. Even if the planet is, if the orbital plane isn't exactly lined up, you still see the star moving because it has some component of motion towards you. Only in the case when it happens to be in the plane of the sky going around, then you wouldn't see anything at all. But even if you had the case where the planet goes directly in front of the star, the planet is only blocking about
2 to 4% of the light of the star, and that doesn't make a really big effect on the spectrum, on the total spectrum. And if it's not in that perfect alignment, it doesn't block any of the starlight. And you see the star, you just look at the spectral lines going back and forth.
And we don't have the instruments yet that can, when it says the side, here's the star over here.
Right.
We can't get the glint off the planet quite yet. We don't have instruments.
Well, we actually do have the Spitzer Space Telescope, which observes in the infrared, has been able to see emission from planets going around the star. And so what you actually see is when the planet, and these happen to be planets that are transiting, so they pass directly in front of the star, and they are really, really close to their star, what we call hot Jupiters. So they have orbital periods of like 4 days. And so if you imagine something that is really, really close to its star, the side facing the star is really hot. The side that's on the other side, not quite so much. And so if you could actually see the emission from the planet, when the planet is here, you don't see quite as much light. And as it comes around like this, and you see that hot face, the planet is emitting light. Now, the Spitzer Space Telescope is not precise enough to separate the planet and the star. So what you basically see is the total emission, but the total emission goes up and down because the planet is going around.
Thank you.
Was another question?
I just wanted to ask, are there detailed spectroscopic properties of brown dwarfs that could also be indicated in like an accretion flow to say whether or not their presence is just
the spectrum of the brown dwarf itself or something?
Right.
Well, so again, the light from the brown dwarf is relatively faint compared to the light in the star, so it's really hard to separate them out. Now, one of the things that that we hope to do is, again, in the optical part of the spectrum, kind of going along the same lines that we talked about here, in the optical, brown dwarfs are as cold as we thought, or even colder. So in the optical, the contrast is just too bad. But as you go to longer and longer wavelengths, it's not quite so bad. But again, the brown dwarf maybe is only in total surface area 5, 6, 7% the size of the star. And so it's a lot smaller and it's a lot colder. So that means you still have a contrast problem in the infrared. It's a factor of maybe 1,000, maybe 10,000. But if you have a really big spectrograph, it's a whole lot of spectrum at once, you might be able to tease it out. And I'm partnering with a group at University of Texas in Austin to build a spectrograph for McDonald Observatory for the 2.7 meter that we might be able to do this with. Unfortunately, all these spectrographs, particularly in infrared, have to cool them down. They operate at very low temperatures. When we cool down the spectrograph, the grating cracks. So we now need to build another one. So it was supposed to be operational this year. It probably won't be operational until next year after. So hopefully that'll come soon, but it's not quite here. Yeah.
So with brown dwarfs having such a heavy mass, from 30 to 8 times the mass of Jupiter, and with the one model having the around supermassive stars, then I would imagine if we had a supermassive star and brown dwarf both sharing a solar system, that doesn't leave a lot of stability for planet formation.
Right. You may, if you have a really massive thing, then it kicks out anything else.
Don't throw it out.
Right. So or tosses it into the star. So you are correct that it leaves less room for there to be kind of normal planets. But you can still have planets either really close to the brown dwarf or really close to the star or really far from either one. You just kind of in the spot where they're kind of sharing the same space with the brown dwarf, then they wouldn't be stable there and they would get kicked out there. Now, that probably means, depending on exactly where that brown dwarf is, it probably means you don't have habitable planets around those stars, because these are really close to the star and they're burning up hot, or they're really far from the star and they're really, really cold. So, yeah, it may well be that you don't have habitable planets around stars that might have a brown dwarf, but you still could have planets. In fact, that Kepler satellite has found planets orbiting double stars. So, you know, Luke Skywalker on Tatooine looking at the double sun. We do know a pair of stars that does have a planet around. Again, the planet's probably so far away it's not habitable, but, you know, Luke Tatooine doesn't exist. Luke Skywalker may not be on it, but Tatooine doesn't exist.
Yeah.
Are any of the planets discovered by the Kepler telescope big enough that the planets could actually be brown dwarfs? Or do any of them cause a large enough decrease in the light from the planet that it could be a brown dwarf?
Right. And so that is something that people are following up. None have been confirmed to be that big. As I mentioned earlier, Jupiter is degenerate in the core. Brown dwarfs are also degenerate in the core. And the mass radius relationship for degenerate objects is different. You kind of always expect, okay, you got the Earth, if you were to put more material in it, the Earth would get bigger. You put more material in it, the Earth would get bigger. Well, for the degenerate objects, it doesn't quite work that way. You put more material in it, it stays about the same size. Put more material in it, stays about the same size. And all Kepler tells you is how big the star is and how big the planet is in front of it. Because all you're measuring is how much light is blocked. Without having a radial velocity determination, you can't measure the mass of that thing that's blocking the light.
Have you seen the closest brown dwarf that was described in today's Nature or read it online? Article by Crossfield, I think his name.
Ian Crossfield?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, but by closest, you mean closest to
Mars?
Yeah, closest to Earth.
So that double brown dwarf, I'm sorry, I don't remember the name,
yeah.
A and B.
Right.
It said other than for Alpha Centauri and Barnard's star, it's the closest.
Right. And so that's a free-floating pair of brown dwarfs. And when I'm talking about this brown dwarf desert, I'm only talking about that in relation to as companions to stars. There are brown dwarfs just out there floating around in space, and we've discovered many of them, and so you're talking about one that's been discovered even more closely. But there are plenty of free-floating brown dwarfs. There just don't seem to be very many that are close companions to stars.
Yeah. I'm just wondering if any of the brown dwarfs would be hanging out and actually become a twin of a double star system. That seems kind of unlikely.
When you say a twin, you mean orbiting double star system?
No. Be one of the two of the double stars.
Well, so, but if we see it as two stars, then there can't be a brown dwarf, because brown dwarfs just wouldn't be producing enough energy to be seen as the two stars.
Let me put this a bit more.
Okay.
When things were forming, maybe the brown dwarf started, and then somehow it started pulling in energy to itself and upgraded itself.
Oh, that it accreted enough material to, so 2001, right, you put all the stuff in, and it starts becoming a star. So you got to create a lot of material to get to that point. It's probably not so. We can measure the accretion rate of the disk material on these stars, and the typical accretion rates are 1/10 millionth of the mass of the sun every year, and if you do that for a million years, you get 0.1 times the mass of the sun. So a star could accrete about 10% of its mass over the lifetime. But you don't form, we see clearly that lower mass stars form a lower mass disk around them. So if you form something that was a brown dwarf, its disk would probably only be able to feed it about 10%. So, yeah, maybe if you had a brown dwarf that formed that had a mass of 75 feet of mass, and you accrete 7.5 feet of mass onto it, it just barely gets over that limit. That's probably not a common thing.
Is there a lot known about the life cycle for the star spots on the younger stars?
They get smaller and smaller as the star gets older and older.
So, like, I mean, a lot of it's just seeing, again, seeing the dots as long as the throw changes.
Right.
That decrease.
Well, so one thing that is kind of interesting, in order for those spots to give us the fake radial velocity signal, because we're observing these stars from one year to the next year to the next year, so that means the spot has to be there and has to basically be in the same place for a long time. Sunspots don't do that. Sunspots stay in the same place. Kind of the biggest ones do it for maybe one or maybe two rotation periods. But these things are all rotating with periods of anywhere from 3 days to 10 days. And if it's going to stay there for 2 years, that means it's lasting for hundreds of rotation periods, tens of hundreds. And that's completely different than what happens on the sun. So it tells us that something about the production of magnetic fields, because spots are magnetic fields, something about the production of magnetic fields on these young stars is very different than what's on the sun.
You talked about the two different theories of why there's a desert one with the big fellows of the star and you're not finding that. So the first one
is that there's just some limit to the whole formation process. The natural one that people come up with is that the disks themselves just aren't big enough to form brown dwarfs in the first place. You know, if you're going to form something that is 20 Jupiter masses, you need enough material to build 20 Jupiter masses. Maybe the disks are just never that big. That would be one thing that could limit it. But people worry about potentially other things that might be going on as well.
So how do brown dwarfs form from smaller disks?
So the brown dwarfs that are just freely floating in space, they probably form in the same way that stars do. They just collapse from a molecular cloud core that happens to be smaller than what forms a star.
I know astronomers are very interested in trying to locate or observe Earth-like planets in terms of mass and being in the Goldilocks position.
Yeah, the habitable zone.
Mm-hmm. And I think if I understand this correctly, that as the generation of the star increases from first, second, and third, the likelihood of that star system, including planets, increases because of the dynamics of the planet forming process as the accretion disk forms the star and the Kikari process, you know, eliminates some of the planets and then, you know, natural processes during the formation of the solar system leads to just the existence of some remaining large objects, which is the planet.
Right. Well, so there's actually a lot of things about planet formation that we don't understand now that we thought we did, and I kind of off over one. One is related to this migration issue. If you form a Jupiter-type planet and it migrates in and maybe gets eaten by a sun, any planets that form inside of that would get shoved along with it. And so, you know, we thought we understood planet formation from our solar system. And then the first planet we discovered was a Jupiter-mass planet that is so close to its star that it's going around every 4.5 days. Jupiter takes 12 years, but that gives you a scale. And it turns out that whole idea of migration was figured out before any of these extrasolar planets were discovered. Some theoreticians worked it out and said, oh, gee, Jupiter should migrate in if it's formed in a disk. And everybody said, well, Jupiter's way out there. You're wrong. You did something wrong. And then when we found all these planets that were really close to the stars, where the guy said, oh, look, I was right. Jupiter's the weird one. We don't know why Jupiter is still where it is. It should have moved as well. And so, you know, if this migration scenario was right, Jupiter would have shoved the Earth and Venus and Mars and Mercury all into the sun and we wouldn't be here. So obviously that didn't happen. And exactly understanding why that didn't happen, people are still struggling with. One idea
it's kind of like this idea that you form a lot of, you form a brown dwarf, it might go between the Teton, the disk mass goes down a little, maybe you form another brown dwarf, it might go between the Teton. Maybe the same thing happened to Jupiter. Maybe you form Jupiter, it might go again and got eaten, and the Earth and everything with it. And then the disk mass went down enough, and then you form another Jupiter, and it migrated in and pushed the Earth and everything with it, and the mass went down. And then you formed that last Jupiter, but you used up enough of what was left in the disk that you no longer had a disk for it to gravitationally interact with it. And so it didn't migrate in. And the planets that formed in that last epoch with it also didn't get shoved in because they're the last guy standing. So that's kind of the way we're thinking that it works now. But there's still a lot of uncertainty of exactly how it all happens.
Yeah, I have one more point. I think there's an enigmatic planet that couldn't have migrated in and couldn't have been formed. It's a hot Jupiter. It couldn't have been formed at the location that it is now. And it's kind of disproving or causing a lot of problems with the current theories of planet formation and force systems throughout the entire planet. But could you use those facts that they've collected from that solar system and the infrared analysis of like third generation stars to maybe form a more advanced theory that could predict or give like assign like a probabilistic quantity to the existence of lower mass planets like Earth mass or Mercury mass planets without seeing a different degree of lustre wobble?
Right. Well, so the low mass planets is just really hard to see fine because they affect their stars so little. But if you look at the number of planets that we do see, so, you know, this shows that we're just now, so if we were to plot Jupiter on this plot, it would be somewhere out about here and up here. So it would be kind of off the edge. But I didn't include the plot, but we now actually know of a few planets that are out there kind of like Jupiter. Now, one of the difficulties in finding Jupiter is that since it takes 12 years to go around, you have to wait 12 years to do the study. And actually, you want to see it go all the way around now, at least twice, you have to wait 24 years. And so, you know, just from practical standpoint, it's not as easy to find Jupiter as it is to find some of these hot Jupiters in here. Nevertheless, we're starting to find ones that are out there. And so they probably do exist. The solar system isn't totally unique, but it's not common. So there probably are other solar systems out there, but maybe their frequency is only about 10%. But we don't yet know because we don't have enough statistics out here to really know what it's like. But you know, that's the whole name of the game. We're trying to take all these observations and refine our models to get a more predictive theory. And it's a work in progress. We're not done with it.
I do have another question. You mentioned that there's one theory that Jupiter and other objects in the inner solar system might have repeated the form and migrated in the focal line.
Right.
And currently, the Earth is stated as not being that much younger than the solar system itself, relatively speaking.
Right, but the error bars on that are in hundreds of millions of years, and we're talking about 10 to 1 million years. So the uncertainty in that gives us plenty of wiggle room to have the Earth form 2 or 3 or 4 times.
Yeah, so that critter does not have implications on our estimated age.
Yeah.
I guess I wanted to switch it a little bit and just ask about the logistics of being an astronomer. You talked about you have 22 days in February. Do you have like a certain time, you know, like 1 hour each night?
So it depends on different telescopes operate in different ways. Most of the telescopes still operate for their scheduled a whole night at a time. This particular one is being scheduled in half night, and so we have 22, 24 half nights. We applied to a committee that read proposals from lots of different people, and they ranked them, and then the top ranked proposals get time. So that's kind of the logistics of it. And that proposal review process happens. Different observatories do it different ways. This particular one does it twice a year. The McDonald Observatory does theirs three times a year. The Hubble Space Telescope does theirs once a year. So it varies a little bit from facility to facility. But they all have proposal deadlines. All the proposals are evaluated by a committee of astronomers, and the highest ranked ones get time. So fortunately, we were high enough ranked to get time. The other thing that I also, when I give more public talks, you know, that observatory is in Hawaii. So I used to go out to Hawaii observing. All my friends thought it was, you know, so tough, because they always imagined me, you know, sitting on the beach drinking Mai Tai while I'm out there observing. That's not the way it is in Hawaii. When you're on the top of Mauna Kea, that Mauna Kea looks like Mars. There's no vegetation there because it's so high and so dry. Turns out there's not a whole lot of oxygen there either. And so you don't think totally straight. Turns out it's kind of ironic because your eyes need oxygen to function properly. And so there's so little oxygen there. When you go outside and it's perfectly clear, you look up, you only see about as many stars as you do here in Houston because your eyes just aren't working. And in fact, the first night that I'm on the mountain in Hawaii, I feel as bad, it's the worst that I've ever felt when I haven't been legitimately sick, because your body doesn't like to live at 14,000 feet. You weren't meant to live at 14,000 feet, and your body lets you know about it when you're there. So going and observing in Hawaii is not as much fun as you might think it is. In fact, it's so little fun that we're actually going to do these observing remotely. All by sitting in my pajamas in my living room.
Do you drink my time to feel better?
Not when you're up there. If you're feeling loud, putting alcohol in your system just makes it worse. All right, well, thank you very much.
A couple quick announcements. One is that there's a sign-in sheet floating around, so if you have a chance, please sign in. Also, for the students in the class, the undergraduates, I do need to get your reports from last week. And don't forget to come to next week's talk. We're going to have Andrew Illen from the Ad-Astra Rocket Company. He's going to be talking about Vasimir and missions to near-Earth asteroids.
Same location?
Same location.